All right, seeing it's a little after 3:35, bring today's Planning Commission meeting to order. This meeting is November 5th, 2014. Want to welcome everyone. It's been a while. Welcome. I'm glad to see everyone. Good smiles. We'll start off with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Great. At this time, we'll take roll call.
Roll call acknowledged.
Looks like we have a full board today. That's great. We'll next go with the welcome and staff introductions, please.
Tom Wiles, Senior Planner.
Courtney Guzman, Planning Manager.
Denise Ledesma, Administrative Aide.
Alan Stumpf, Assistant Director.
Ani Sakina, Deputy City Attorney.
Great. All right. At this time, we'll open up for comments from the public for any items that are not on today's agenda. All right. Seeing none, well, we'll close the open public comment period, and we'll move to approval of the minutes from June 25th, 2014. I believe those were in everyone's packet if they've had a chance to review them. Any questions, comments, or motions?
I move that the minutes be approved.
Okay, I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Okay.
Actually, forgive me, my packet got left on my kitchen sink, but I remember having a question. So can I discussion on the motion?
You bet.
So I remember that the minutes, there were a couple action items, and I know that we switched over, thank you. We switched over recently, the last few meetings, to not having a lot more detailed minutes, and that's fine for a lot of reasons. But one thing that it seemed to me to be particularly useful for council, in particular, the mayors, other council members have commented to me that it was really helpful to have such, rich minutes for dicey issues in particular and in previous applications over the years. But obviously, if that's not going to happen, what I think could happen, though, and when I look at the list of public hearing attendees, frequently when folks come up, it's pretty clear, or it can be made clear, are they in support of the application, in opposition? Or maybe even if it's informational. Because as a council member, if I were to see this at some point, and they're like, okay, there's 30 people that show up, that's fine, their rank and serial number, but if it's not clear, like, okay, I think it means something when 30 people show up in opposition to something and there's one or two in support of it, and vice versa. Mm-hmm. So to the extent that we can recommend that or require that, I'd like to maybe have that as a discussion item for us. I don't know if that's, maybe staff can let us know about what may be appropriate for that.
Mr. Chair, is this discussion on the motion, or are we going to talk more about this later? Because I think that's a very good point.
Yeah, I think what we'd like to do is maybe take this to future agenda items, item J, have a further discussion on this, and if that's okay with you, Commissioner Huerta?
I like your motion.
Okay, great. So what I'd like to do then is have the original motion and the second stand and move the comments Commissioner Huerta brought up to item J later this afternoon, and take a vote on that motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? None? All right.
One abstention.
One abstention is noted. Commissioner Araujo. Great.
Could I address the council or the commission just quick? This was in relation to the Verizon use permit. Is that right?
No, we're not there yet.
Okay, sorry about that. I showed up at the county, not the city. My apologies.
No problem. Okay, great. Okay, so now moving to item F, public hearings. So first item today is conditional use permit number 2014-013, a request to construct and operate a major telecommunications facility at LaSalle High School, consisting of a removal of an existing 70-foot light pole and construction of an 80-foot high light pole located at 777 Williams Road in the PS-AP, which is a public, semi-public airport overlay district. We'll first hear a report from Thomas Wiles, Senior Planner.
Thank you very much, Chairperson Noel. Commissioners, this is application conditional use permit 2014-013, proposal request to construct and operate a major telecommunications facility at LaSalle High School. The project site is located on the southwest portion of the LaSalle High School track and football field, just near Williams Road on the southwest corner of the campus. The proposals from Verizon Wireless, the Salinas Union High School District is property owner. The proposal is to remove an existing pole and antennas, so which is 70 foot in height. Three antennas relocated approximately 40 feet to the southwest with a new proposed 80 foot new light pole with 9 antennas and with a 77 foot radius and an expanded support equipment area. The property is located in the public, semi-public airport overlay zoning district, and there are residential and school uses that are adjacent to the project site. This shows the elevation, the proposed elevations of the site. This is the existing pole, and then this is the new proposed pole would have a new light standard, and the antennas would be 10 feet on top of the new light standard. This would be relocated, and this is looking from the southwest elevation. This would be southeast elevation. This shows the site plan. This would be the antenna. This is the track of the current stadium. This is Williams Road. This would be the expanded support area for the proposed major telecommunications facility. General plan designation for the site is public and semi-public, and it's consistent with the goals for LU general land use goal LU1, since it will provide additional telecommunication services to the community, and also since it's on an infill site, it will be consistent with land use policy LU2.4. It is located, as stated, in the PSAP district. This shows a go back here. Okay. Sorry about that. This shows a photo simulation actually of the site. This is the existing site, and this is the proposed site. And in the PSAP district, major telecommunications facilities require a conditional use permit, consideration of a conditional use permit. Planning Commission consideration is required for the proposed 7-foot radius. Maximum is 5, but the 7-foot radius is allowed to consideration from the Planning Commission with the CUP process. If the major telecommunication facility is proposed, any future co-location will not require discretionary action. On October 8, 2014, an initial study was done for the site mitigation, mitigated negative declaration with a 20-day review period, which ended on October the 28th. The only response we received was from the Monterey Bay Unified Air Pollution Control District, which stated that they reviewed and had no comments on the application. There are two specific mitigation measures concerning the FCC. One is that signs will be posted for safety you know, provide for safety measures for individuals working near the site. And the other is that any future proposed antennas will require an RF study to show that they comply with Federal Communications Commission rules and regulations. And therefore, staff believes that the proposed conditional use permit application is consistent with both the general plan and zoning code that will help to provide telecommunication services to the city of Salinas. The initial study did not identify any significant environmental impacts. Therefore, staff recommends that the Planning Commission affirm the findings and adopt the resolution, which adopting the mitigated negative declaration and mitigation monitoring reporting program, and approve the conditional use permit. The public notices were posted at the City Hall, the Permit Center, and on-site on October 7th and October 9th, and it was published in Salinas, California on October the 10th. Are there any questions of staff at this time?
Commissioners, any questions or comments? Great. Seeing no questions or comments from the commissioners, we'll open up to a public hearing, receive public comments. Maybe we first invite the applicant if they're present. When you have come to the podium, please state your name and affiliation.
My name is Greg Brown. I work with Epic Wireless Group, a vendor for Verizon Wireless, and represent the applicant, Brett Ewing, who also works with Epic Wireless. And Brett could not be here today, but I'm in his stead to answer any questions you may have about the project.
Great. Any other comments or people from the public that would like to address the issue? All right, seeing none, turn it back to the commission.
My first question is, how close is this facility going to be to the existing grandstands?
I believe it'll probably be about 25 to, no, actually, give me just one second.
Sure.
I believe it'll be 40 feet from the existing tower to the southwest. In fact, I know it to be 40 feet, which the existing stand or existing light pole is closer to the grandstands than the new one will be. And I would say that it's probably the new one or the old one is probably 15 feet or so, right on the track. And the grandstands are probably from the lowest point, maybe 15 feet.
So, okay. What's the purpose of relocating the actual pole? Is that improve light in the actual stadium, or is it something related to performance of your equipment and cell tower performance?
It's a combination of several. First of all, for the school's sake, they have just recently put down a new track, mm-hmm. and we did not want to disturb the track after they spent all that money. The newer location allows for that not to happen, or a greater chance that it won't happen. Second of all, the reason for a new pole is the existing pole structurally will not hold the new modifications, which would prohibit any kind of addition to the existing tower. Another reason is we could really create a lot of disturbance for the school by removing that pole and then having to remove the existing foundation that was there. And so the school, knowing that we needed another pole anyway to hold the new equipment, agreed to let us put up a new light standard. The lighting should not change. Musco, which the school is requiring us to use, will be the company that makes the lighting, puts the lighting up, tests the lighting to make sure that the school has done everything that they need to do. Second of all, on top of your approval, we will be going to the Division of State Architect for review and approval for their whole process as well. So we have a whole nother review process to go through the Division of State Architect. Did that adequately answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
If you don't mind, I have two other questions.
Sure, fire away.
Some of the other cell phone towers we've seen presented to us in the past have had, I guess what's, for a lack of a proper term, a white shroud, if you will, that covers the actual antenna devices. It's circular, it's like maybe 3 feet wider in diameter than the actual pole itself. So it's the antennas are actually behind this white cylinder, if you will, to conceal them. I'm curious as if that is, can that not be done here for improved aesthetics, or is there a reason why this type of cell tower with these branch arms is required?
Well, the reason the extension and the arms are required is separation required between the antennas for radio frequency purposes. If they're too close to one another, it creates interference and issues with the radio signals, et cetera. So that's one of the main reasons. I think the design that we have here was designed to be consistent with what is already on the three other, if you will, corners of the field. And so I think that's the main reason for that. They will be, I can't remember if the antennas will be painted to match the pole, but if you put up a contraption of any sort, it's probably going to create more, draw more attention to it than if it's just mounted up there. The best way to disguise something like that would be a monopine or a tree pole, which in this particular instance would not work because it's a light standard, and really a tree sitting right next to the pole that just wouldn't work. That's more for something near, exactly near a residential area. But as you can see, the existing sites that are there now are making use of those poles and trying not to put up a whole nother tower so as to minimize the number that are around. Okay. So.
And then I'm assuming you also represent the school district. You're here on their behalf, or is there someone from the school district, or I'm assuming they approve of this, or she wouldn't be here today? Or is I?
Currently, I'm working with Karen Luna, the director of facilities with the school district, and she has approved the project. Prior to the need for a new pole, we had requested approval of the expansion of the equipment area to include the generator, and they approved that, but then a second project came along and we decided to lump them all together. But they are, the school board is reviewing, or actually has reviewed and approved the project, and we are now in the stage of just documenting it with an amendment to our existing lease agreement with them. Okay. So it has been approved, but yes, no one is here that I know.
And then lastly, I didn't see a lighting photometric plan. Is that something you submit later, or is that reviewed internally by staff? Because we're moving a light, I mean, it's a pretty substantial light that you're moving, and I don't know if that study has been done. I know you're across the street and from a residential area, so and lights facing towards the field, but I don't know if that's required or if that's been taken in consideration in your application.
To be honest with you, I don't know if it's required either. I know we'd be happy to make sure that there's no issue with lighting for the neighboring residential areas. I know one thing, we won't just put them up and go away. They will be to the school standards because since we're taking lighting down and then putting new lighting up, I guarantee you there won't be an issue. And if there is an issue, then we can address that for certain. But I would yield to Mr. Wiles on whether or not that's a community development requirement. But I know for sure Verizon would not want any adverse publication or issues with the community. And so if there's any lighting issues, we would definitely fix those. But I would say this too, Verizon will not install the lights. We are not expert light installers, if you will. Musco Lighting will do that, and that will be under the school supervision, and the school will tell them exactly what they want, and we've agreed to do that. So,
okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Commissioner Huerta.
Thank you, Chair. And you mentioned earlier that the process still entails going to the division or the state architect. Right. Can you tell us a little bit more about that process?
Sure. It'll probably take us 6 to 8 or 9 months to get through it. They will inspect our design, our footings, make sure it's up to state codes. Any portion of the foundation that is poured, they will have an inspector on site to make sure it is poured exactly as required by state code. The school hires the inspector, because if we hired it, it would look like it could be a potential conflict of interest. So the school hires them, and they actually have an inspector of record that they use all the time. And so that will be the individual that represents the state, and he is certified by them. But that process, we will submit the A&E drawings that were submitted here to the city. They will review them, make their revisions of any sort, in order to permit it. But anytime we do anything on a school property, it has to go through the DSA review. But it will go through their whole engineering process as well. And they will issue basically a DSA approval, and then the inspector of record is hired, and he'll have to watch the whole process. In fact, it's down to the science where if the pole, which I can't believe this actually happens, but if the light standard, the 80-foot pole, is made in New Orleans, the inspector of record has to go there and watch them make the pole. It's that detailed. So for the record, it's a pretty detailed process, and we expect it to not be quick.
Thank you. Sounds like a fun job at the state. All right. Appreciate that.
Yes. We've been through it plenty of times.
Any other questions or comments for the applicant?
Yes. As an alumni of the first graduating class of LSL High School, thank you, the first primary question is, this light change won't occur until after football season, right?
Oh, we have told the school that we will we'll abide by whatever process for constructing this they want us to go through. Obviously, it will not be during football season, for sure, or any other season that requires that lighting there. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we've already been in communication with them about that, and also working on just making sure that we've got every base covered as far as equipment and installation and timing, et cetera. So yes, it will all be scheduled. We'll have a construction schedule that they'll approve mm-hmm. or reject.
I have two other questions. First one, is this a sole use facility by Verizon?
Right, but per the city requirements, it will be co-locatable, I believe. So that's always, I believe, always a city requirement.
And my other question is kind of nebulous, I guess you would say. How does this benefit the high school as opposed to just the school district? How does it specifically benefit the high school, financially or whatever?
Well, financially, it benefits the school district, but for the students and anyone actually in that area, the main benefit is for data purposes with any kind of cell phone device or pad or laptop that uses a Verizon service. For example, now we are actually building sites that primarily deal with data, not even voice, mm-hmm. because believe it or not, your cell phone most of the time these days is not really even making for a call. It's all for data. And so data gets jammed in there. The site can't handle it. And so new technology comes out, and it helps increase the flow of data, which benefits students and people in the community. But if you've ever had your cell phone and you can't get through and you're like, man, this is slow, the fiber is directly to the antennas through these RRUs and RRHs, remote radio heads, which, without being too technical, prevents us from having to run a fiber cable up there. It just runs straight through this RRU, which promotes faster speed, faster data, which means your cell phones and your tablets and everything work quicker. But it has more capacity. You can only do so much when you're doing voice and data. So that's the benefit to the students. Most of you, if you don't have students, you obviously have seen them all. Their heads are buried there, or it's on their tablet, and maybe that's you, like me, and you want to be able to process more data. And so that's part of it. Texting, assignments on pads, that type thing.
Okay. I'd like to thank you for your help in clarifying some of those things, because I will have an alumni association to answer to. Why did you vote that way?
Yeah. Sure. Well, thank one you. Of the reasons we actually, I mean, we've been at the site for some time, And as technology grows and changes, it does necessitate making modifications. And so we thought, like, rather than trying to move a site, it's better to work with an existing location that already has a pole that prevents just putting up another pole in the air just to achieve our purposes. It does really benefit the community. And incidentally, one of the modifications and the expansion of the existing equipment is the inclusion of a 30 kW generator. Obviously this conversation is on the record, but when Hurricane Sandy hit in the Northeast, most of Verizon's sites did not go down because they had a lot of backup power. The FCC has not demanded or mandated at this point that every wireless site have a generator, but because wireless is so critical to the infrastructure, the communication infrastructure of the country, they're really asking for sites to be backed up so that in the event of a natural disaster or anything of that nature, the site remains on air. A lot of them do have batteries, but in the form of a natural disaster, your level of phone calling goes up, which means the batteries drain quicker, whereas this generator would remain online longer, which helps your community. It helps with any other emergency service or any other city service or business that uses Verizon service. So there's a lot of benefits to it, to the community, not just the data and the pole. The backup power is actually pretty critical.
One more question, Commissioner Hill.
Just out of curiosity, do you know if Alisal High School has any other telecommunication towers on their side? I don't know if you can answer that or not. But
if the school actually has some of their own and
no,
owns them?
Another company, mobile.
Oh, yes.
Or
yes, sir. AT&T is present. T-Mobile is present. Sprint, and I believe, or Metro PCS. But I know Sprint and Nextel are pretty much the same these days, and so one of those sites may have been decommissioned. I do not know that. But they are on the other poles, the light poles, surrounding the field.
Thank you.
I don't think we'll ever hear of a student complaining there.
Yeah, my reception's horrible here, right?
Well, it's actually one of my questions is, so geographically, can you speak to that? Like how far... How much more strength would somebody living in that area? Are you saying residents living in the area too would benefit, or is this?
Oh yes. Oh.
So
yeah.
How far do you have a sense of that?
To be honest with you, I wouldn't even want to take a stab at that because I'm not a professional RF engineer. But the way it works is those antennas are up at the top, and those antennas have a radiation pattern, It could be elliptical, it could be funnel, and azimuth and the down tilt all affect how that works. Well, obviously, Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile all have a network. So I don't know where all of Verizon's towers are in this area, but this one will work inside the network, and wherever their patterns are, this one will work to provide as much coverage as it can. Where the other towers are not. It's primarily for residential and use and anybody going up and down Williams Avenue or Williams Road. But yes, the benefits to the residents are the same as with the students. The data, the amount of data that you can process with your smartphone or your tablet, it's huge. It will be a major difference. So that benefits anyone in that area, but as far as the distance goes, I would not want to go on record as saying something that I really don't know. That's more of an engineering thing as far as the exact pattern.
Okay.
But I would say this, it's going to be more than a mile or two, I can tell you that. I mean, it's good coverage, I would think.
Thank you.
Sure.
Great. Thank you. Seeing no other questions, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, at this time, I'll return it back to the commission board. Any other further discussion or anyone want to entertain a motion?
I want to make a comment, actually, because I know there's been previous applications in recent months or when we were meeting more often. And one of the things that I think I've asked for in the past and the staff has been able to provide is a map showing really all the major telecommunications across the city. There have been in recent years some controversy around some of the towers. I'll remember one that was at Natividad Medical Center, and you know, where it was high up, it was in the middle of the area, but then there was concern about, is there gonna be, you know, interference with life-saving devices and these other things, and what about the cumulative effects of all these different towers going up, and at some point, and now you're looking at this stadium, a pretty small geographic area, and it's got four or five in the same vicinity. Four. And I actually would challenge anybody to go across the rest of the city and point out where there's actually four like that in the same very short, small geographic area. I don't know, but my sense is that that may or may not be the case, but at some point, the inexact science of all this may catch up to us in 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and, you know, God forbid anything bad, but, you know, along the way, let's try to get a hold of the information and understand it well enough so that we can prevent anything that may potentially be out there that we're not aware of, right? We only know what we know. So I'm not saying that we freak out. I'm just saying that let's be sure to get a handle on what we're approving instead of just always continuously saying, yeah, I want more power, I want more access, this, that, and the other. At some point, it's going to have an impact.
Didn't Hartnell have, that we approved, was a multiple antenna facility?
I don't know if
that was. I think it was like four antennas, one on each corner of the...
Same company.
Yeah, I know. But I'm just saying we're talking about a number of towers in a given location.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that may be.
But I think Commissioner Huerta's comment is interesting because having a general overall citywide map of where these are, I almost kind of equate it to like, I believe it's called the Cortese website, where for... sites that have contaminants or other site issues, that there's a website and an overall citywide site plan, if you will, that you can locate them all. And I don't know if there's something like that that's available for us in the future as a resource to maybe, you know, help understand relationships to that, to just help better inform all of us and the public as well. So. Certainly, yeah, willing to open up back to...
Well, what I was going to suggest for you all, as I indicated earlier, I'm not an RF engineer. They're the ones that design the networks and where they need a tower based on coverage. And I know for other jurisdictions that I've worked in, from whether it's Bakersfield, Fresno, up to Grass Valley, or even in Nevada, that... there are times where if you want an education, so to speak, the best place to go is to the people who are designing the networks. And I think if you reached out to a Verizon and said, hey, we would like to have a meeting so that we can understand a wireless network and how you're designing it so that we as a commission can make sure that we're doing the best thing for our city, that would be a welcomed opportunity because, as you have suggested before, at commission meetings, it's not uncommon for someone to stand up and say, that thing's going to be 100 feet from my house, and I'm going to end up with scrambled eggs for a brain. And I've seen it all happen, which couldn't be further from the truth. And yet, if you were on top of that antenna doing work, we turn the site down so that no one's exposed. But to have a better understanding, which I think is what you're asking for, of how these networks work and are there issues, and not just a Verizon, but to have an AT&T, which I'm sure the city has contacts for all the vendors such as myself who come in and make application and proposals, that to sit down and say, hey, can you work in conjunction with us? Because you guys are not in the network development for telecommunications, but if that's your desire to understand it, I think it helps even Verizon know that, hey, the city of Salinas is wanting to make sure that they understand this, and this is an opportunity for us to help you guys understand, because if someone comes in and does contest this, you have background knowledge and education that says, okay, I think your concerns are a little, you know, maybe they're validated, maybe they're not. But technically, wherever we propose a site, we already know your conditions and your wireless ordinance. And we're not typically going to choose that unless there's just no option. So,
just to clarify, isn't this a replacement for an existing Verizon tower?
Yes, sir.
So it's not a new tower, it's a replacement.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you.
Okay. Just want to say something. There's this paragraph that says for future collocation. And I would say that if we are going to approve that this be taken out, because it says that we allow them to, I guess, add more antennas or do changes to the antennas in the future without having them come to us, to the Planning Commission. Is that how I understand that? That's on page 3.
Yes, any future co-location, be it the administratively approved minor modification, as long as it complies with the zone code requirements and the terms and conditions of the conditional use permit.
But does that mean that any other carriers can add antennas?
It would allow for co-location additional antennas per the minor modification, minor modification to the conditional use permit. Then they would have to comply once with the zone code and with the terms and conditions of the draft CUP approval document.
Oh, okay.
Tom, could you elaborate on that a little bit? What would you consider a minor modification? Obviously, increasing the height of the pole would be major.
Well, that would be a major. It would be... brand new antennas that would have to be located below, like, the light standard. It couldn't go above the 80 feet, or could not increase the height of the tower. It also it could not exceed 5-foot radius. One of the things is why this is going to the Planning Commission is because they want a 7-foot radius for the antennas. If they wanted to go 7-foot for any future antenna, any co-locator, then they would have to come back to the Planning Commission for review and consideration. But any new antennas would have to be located below the light standard. It could not increase the height of the pole without, that would be an amendment. That would have to go back to Planning Commission.
So if they want to add another pole, that would come to us?
That's a whole nother, yeah, that would be,
okay.
This would have to be specifically on this pole. So if they want to say, like, they put 60 on, you know, another, because this is going to be a proposed 80-foot pole, if they put, there's the California, pursuant to the California Government Code Section 65850.6, is that future co-location of additional telecommunications carriers on the subject facility does not require discretionary action. That's in page 3 of the staff report. But any, you know, like any new pole, that would definitely, that would require another CUP. But, you know, if, you know, somebody putting another set of antennas, let's say 60 or 70 feet up on this pole, or, you know, 50 or 60, then that might be a minor modification administrative, as long as they're within terms of conditions of the CUP approval document. But if they wanted to, say, increase the height of it or go beyond the 5-foot radius, then they would have to come back here for consideration.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay. Any further discussion?
Motion to approve conditional use permit 2014-13.
We have a motion.
Second.
You have a second. Okay. We can take a roll call vote.
Chairperson Knorr?
Yes.
Vice Chair Minks?
Yes.
Commissioner Hill?
Aye.
Commissioner Huerta?
Yes.
Commissioner Ibarra?
Yes.
Commissioner Rahul?
Yes.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Great. All right, conditional use permit 14-013, a request to construct and operate a major telecommunications facility at Alisaw High School consisting of removal of an existing 70-foot high light pole and construction of a new 80-foot high light pole located at 77 Williams Road in the PS-AP Public Semi-Public Airport Overlay District. The Planning Commission has just approved the conditional use permit. The request for conditional use permit, which cannot be issued for 10 days, during this 10-day period, any person having standing to do so under the law who is aggrieved by this action or decision may file an appeal with the Community and Economic Development Department located at 65 West Alisaw Street. Great, thank you. Okay, with that, that'll close our public hearings, item F, and we'll go to item G, commission considerations.
I'm not aware of them, but I think there was a question perhaps about the agenda. This might be a good spot to put it.
Yeah, let's move that there then. So, Commissioner Huerta, going back to your earlier comments about maybe finding a way to better document the public comments and people there, kind of surveying, you know, hey, who was in favor, maybe in disposition of it. See how we can maybe better document this and serve, you know, the city council and mayor so they get a better, or anyone reading these future meeting minutes.
Yeah, I mean, if we're going to be listing everybody who shows up, it seems to me to make that more meaningful for the council members who did more than likely didn't attend the meeting. At least they have a better sense of, you know, those individuals, their potential affiliation, and then whether they just in a very quick, easy way, are you in favor of the application? Are you opposed to it? Are you informational? I mean, you can pretty much very quickly and easily put them into one of those three buckets.
So I have something I'd like to say about that. I think it's a wonderful idea. And I would want to remove staff's discretion for making those determinations. I think it puts staff in a really difficult position. One of the reasons why I'm not a fan of the way we used to do minutes. And I really like just putting what the actions are. I see a great merit in having positions stated, but let's put the onus on the speaker. Perhaps as a strategy, the chair could formulate some verbiage when we welcome comments from the public, saying kindly state your support, opposition, or if your comments are informational. So it removes the staff from having to make that determination, because people come up, and I hope that it's richer than that. That people,
maybe a green card, red card?
Well, something. I mean, I hope people are coming up with a spirit of curiosity, asking for information, offering information, making sure we're thinking of questions that they didn't see evidenced in the prepared materials, so that we're not just buying into this thumbs up, thumbs down. You know, comments are often richer than that. So maybe the term informational or something, but I don't have an exact answer. I just would like to say, let's take it out of the hands of staff of making those determinations.
I agree with that.
If I could suggest also that we'll consult with the city clerk who does minutes for the city council and see what kind of process criteria that they use for their minutes and ensure that ours are at least consistent, meet that minimum, but then we'll look at if there's anything above that that we can also do to address the commission's concerns regarding a reflection of who in the audience might be for or against a project. And we'll come back at the next meeting and report on that.
That's great. Appreciate it.
Are we talking about here for information for the city council, such as that in general, 40 people showed up who are adamantly against this proposal? I mean, I think that the city council should know that so many people showed up and this was a general consensus of the group. Is that what we're talking about? I mean, not specifics of Joe said this and Frank said that and Ed said this. So I'm not clear on that part.
So can I see the minutes again? So the minutes we just approved earlier from the last meeting, if you look at page 2, right? So those of you that were here at that meeting, to illustrate, it might help somebody else along the line know that, okay, well, the Mr. Mancera, or obviously for it, right? But then what did the owner of the nearby or next door property think about it? And then what did the, oh, so support of brother applicant. See, so there's information right there. He says support. But what did the owner of 223 think? And so in parentheses, it can just be support or oppose or informational. That's it. And I totally agree. I do definitely agree that the onus should be put on the speaker, and that can be the directed to say, okay, please come forward. Next speaker, please name. Are you for or are you speaking in favor of? I mean, this isn't anything new. I've been in other councils in other cities that do that. So, and especially now, I think it's more important because we're so abbreviated in our minutes.
Could I make one comment on that? From a staff perspective, we could say that the owner of 723 Alice House Street was concerned about parking on his property. That doesn't necessarily mean he supported or did not support the application. He had concerns with it regarding parking. There are the resources on the web. The meetings are taped, and they are completely available to the public 24/7, or council members can look at those as well. We can take the next step and maybe modify the format a little bit, but sometimes it's difficult to find or to understand whether someone supports something or they just have a comment about it. Just to throw that out there, it's not always crystal clear if they're supporting or against something.
Right, so what we're asking is that some verbiage besides support, not support, information, comments be stated by the speaker. So the staff doesn't have to do that. They don't have to determine that.
And then Denise would have to pick that up or pick that out of the presentation.
No, here's an example. Based on the instructions from the chair, I come up and I say, I am Karen Araujo, I'm a resident of Salinas. I'd like to speak in support of this. And then I would talk. Or I would say, da 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 da, I have some comments and questions. And then I would speak. Or I would say whatever, and I'd say, oh yeah, I'm supposed to say support, don't support, or have comments. I guess I'm not in support of it. So it would be on me as a speaker.
So potentially the minutes might say that this owner or this next door owner had a comment about the project. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't necessarily say they supported it or were against it, but they commented on it.
Right. It could say could just have brackets, comment, question, support, not support.
Could be a couple different outcomes then.
Sure.
Got it. Okay.
Is what has been uttered here as a possibility.
Agree.
Right. Yeah, it's just not always crystal clear whether they support or not support. Thanks.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Next item, other business. I believe we have a presentation today on code enforcement. Welcome.
Yes, Mr. Chair, this is in response to a Planning Commission request made some time ago. It's taken a little bit of time for logistically to bring a presentation to you, but we welcome Sylvia Perez. She's the Senior Code Enforcement Officer for the city. It's a small but mighty staff that herself and two other code enforcement officers assume to have an additional code enforcement officers, so we'll have a staff of three starting early December. So Sylvia has her presentation, and please proceed.
Sure. Good afternoon, Commissioners. My name is Sylvia Perez. I am the Senior Code Enforcement Officer for our Code Enforcement Division for the City of Salinas in our Community Economic Development Department. I brought with me Teresa Kistler. She's my weed abatement revenue technician officer. And I'll go ahead and start with my presentation. So what is code enforcement? I have a mission statement. I'll read the first sentence, and then the rest is there for you to read. The City of Salinas is unique due to the surrounding beauty of our agricultural land. We do have a due process, and we are complaint-driven. We are not proactive at this time. When we receive a complaint, depending on the type of complaint that we receive, we either send out a courtesy letter, and courtesy letters go out when it's a blight and violation, meaning inoperable vehicles, parking on the lawn, fences, signs, anything that's visual from the street. We will send a courtesy letter in hopes that it will take care of the violation. We will then send an inspector to verify if those blight violations have been removed. Another thing when we do a complaint, blight complaints can be called in anonymously. When we do get complaints for housing, illegal garage conversions, we do have to have the person's name and phone number in case we do need to contact them for officer safety reasons, because we want to know what's kind of going on in that neighborhood. When we do have an inspector go out there, they'll verify if there is a violation, if it's been cleared. If there is a violation, we do issue a notice of violation, giving them a time frame to comply. After which, if they do not comply within that time frame, we go down the process of our administrative remedy, which will then issue a citation of 100, 200, going up to 500, and 500 thereafter. If they still do not comply, then we do go to the compliance order, where we're ordering them to comply and remove violations, giving them a certain time frame. If they don't comply within this time frame, then we go and have an administrative hearing, where our hearing officer could issue daily fines up to $2,500 on violations that are not removed within a certain time frame. And of course, if that still doesn't work, we go through the criminal prosecution portion. We have agencies within the city that we work closely with, which is with police, fire, with our legal department, housing services, maintenance and environmental compliance, animal control. We also work with Monterey County and their agencies, environmental health, hazardous materials, housing authority, adult protective services are just a few that we work for, and of course with the Bureau of Automotive Repairs. For the fiscal year 13-14, we received approximately 634 complaints in, as you can see, it's a list of the type of complaints that we received. I have provided some before and after pictures of some zoning violations. Here we have an inoperable vehicle, prohibited vehicle, illegal auto repair, accumulation of auto parts here, and this is how it looks after it's been complied with. Here we have work without a permit. It's a patio cover, but it's also more than just work without permit. We have accumulation of garbage, substandard housing conditions. This is after they vacated and took care of the violations. Here is a prohibited fence. It's a corner side yard. We have a 6-foot fence right up to the sidewalk. They built it, even where you see the greenhouse, it's encroached into the front yard setback as well. So now they reduced it and met compliance. And these are just a couple of the things that we do in code enforcement. The number you call is 758-7157. We do need the address when you call and make a complaint. And that concludes my presentation. And one more thing I'd like to also mention. For the year 13-14, the code enforcement have collected at least close to $10,000 in inspection fees. And we've received $20,000 with our citations. This year, from July to October, we have gained about $36,000, and that's through through one of our compliance orders where there was a violation, a property sold, and we were able to collect some of the money with one of our compliance orders. So our process does work. It might take a long time for it. It doesn't look like nothing's being done, but it does work. If you have any questions?
Yes. First off, yard sales, that's code enforcement?
No.
Who is it then?
The first responder should be the police department. There was a time when we did have a staff member who was working on the weekends, assisting the police, doing the garage sales over the weekends. But when we lost a couple of personnel, we had to stop doing that process.
Okay.
Any other questions?
But you're talking about one other thing. You're talking about building permits. Do you have any, because of all the roofing that goes on weekends, do you have an officer on duty during the weekends?
We usually don't do work without permits. Usually the building inspector's the ones that do that, but if we do see it, we do respond, you know, to it, but now for during the weekends, we do not.
And that's when it all occurs. That's what we call it out where I live in the LSL. You hear a roofing on a weekend, it's called no permits.
Correct.
Thank you.
Correct. It's true. I've seen quite a bit, and usually when I do see it out there, I do forward it to my building inspectors on Monday after the work is done.
Thank you very much for that report and for all you do. You have a lot on your shoulders. A lot is expected of code enforcement, mm-hmm. and like so many, you know, places, the staff is so different now than it was years ago. I'm happy to hear you're going to get another person. Will it still be complaint driven, or will this be enough staff that you will have someone out in the field?
No, this is we're still low on staff. Basically, the position that we got filled is the position that I left open when I became the senior code enforcement officer.
Got it.
So right now I have my two full-time code enforcement officers who are assigned three council districts each. I do have a part-time code enforcement officer who does the blight by complaint only, and it's only two times a week that I do have an officer go out there for blight. So we don't have the staff. And what I'm hoping for is when we do get that new staff, we'll be doing more blight inspections throughout the whole city.
And is it part of your, I don't know how the city operates, from a budget standpoint or putting in requests through economic development or something, is there a staffing level at which you anticipate you would be able to have, get that those wheels on the street instead of complaint driven?
I'll have Alan answer that question.
thank you, Sylvia, and members of the commission. The source document for that answer is actually the Citygate report. City Council has had its eye on and a priority for code enforcement for quite some mm-hmm. time. It's been part of the discussion with the tax measures and so on. Mm-hmm. I think the community realizes that the level of expectation for code compliance in the city of Salinas really needs to rise. When the Citygate report, which was an organizational study of the Community and Economic Development Department and particularly the Permits Center, when they reviewed the report, they wanted more specifics, just like you were asking. And so Citygate went back and did a supplemental report, and they surveyed a number of communities in this area and equivalent in size and so on. They came up with a number of 8 code enforcement officers in total. Mm-hmm. And we think that would be sufficient to actually take a preemptive approach to code enforcement, and when we see things that are out of compliance, to actually act on them without a complaint. And I think that would certainly raise the whole level of beautification in the community, reducing blight, and improving property values as well. That's our intent when When the upcoming budget process comes through, we'll certainly be pushing for more code enforcement officers to address that need. We're also looking at potentially some other functions with code enforcement with that large, you know, with that larger staff. I think we could do more otherwise as well. Have perhaps consider, and this will segue into discussion of some other initiatives that we have going on, but other communities actually have a proactive inspection program for residential rental properties in their communities, not just multifamily, but all rental properties. So that's certainly a consideration up for discussion. And those sorts of things pay for themselves, and they prevent dangerous things from occurring as well. So, and they improve the quality of life for residents in the community. And that's really what Sylvia and her staff are working towards.
Great. Thank you for that. And really, thank you so much for what your staff is doing.
Thank you.
Would you do me a favor and define for me blight?
What is blight?
In your context.
Anything that you could see visually on a property, from inoperable vehicles parked in the driveway, parking on the lawn, having junk cars, dilapidated fence. When we see garbage and rubbish, we usually forward those to the health department. But of course, if there's other zoning violations pertaining to that, we'll also take care of the rubbish. Weeds, you know, that's something else that you could see visually. In the commercial area, you're talking about the signs, banners, you see it all over. Once some of them comply and some others don't, and when they comply, they just repeat the violation later on.
My question is, because we have a commercial property at the end of my street that's become a dumping ground. I mean, the owner refuses, my councilman has talked to this person until they're blue in the face, refuses to do anything about it. They, you know, just for information purposes, maybe you can give me a lead who to talk to. Stuff that gets dumped on the property, like couches, mattresses, they take it and move it into the street instead of, that's what I'm saying. I need to see what can be done to maybe encourage that property owner, commercial property owner, to do something about it.
Complain. They get it taken care of.
Correct.
Complain to them?
You could complain to us, and then we'll go ahead and forward it to the health department. Okay. The health department will turn around and contact us if they need us to be out there as well. And sometimes we working both together sometimes helps with the compliance effort.
Don't leave before we're done then.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, I still have some questions. I have questions, actually,
sorry.
If you don't mind.
No, not here. Yeah, sorry.
Thank you. I really appreciate it, actually. I was one of the more vocal ones, very excited about your presentation. Okay. Code enforcement is very dear to my heart.
Thank you.
So thank you for all that you do, and I know that you have a monumental task in front of you. I heard earlier that the fees don't cover all of the outlay. We understand that. And I know that fees have been a topic of discussion and everything else. Do you think it would be a deterrent to increase fees, particularly for repeat offenders?
I encourage it.
Right.
As a matter of fact, before I started in code enforcement, what I'd like to also point out is I've been doing code enforcement for 12 years. So 12 years before I started working, I was a permit clerk. And what I noticed is the garage conversions, when you got your permit to restore your garage to vehicular use, was only $45. So when you're collecting $500 in rent, $45 to get your permit, remove your violations, have the inspector go out and do an inspection, clear the violation, and they'll just turn around and go right back and convert it again. We go back, charge them $45. So one of the proposals that I did when I became a code enforcement officer was for these repeat violators to get a $300 investigation fee, double building permit fee, so that way if they do violation, it's not gonna cost them $45, it's gonna cost them over $300.
Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. I do a lot of my work in San Jose, and they have a pretty aggressive program around the rental properties. Not enough for the
home rentals, condos, and all those things. But what they have been better at is, at least periodically, they have pretty much all of the apartments, right? Apartment through the occupancy permit process on a 3 to 6 year cycle. And so what that does is it kind of puts everybody kind of on notice that at some point you're going to have to get your act together. And they've more recently streamlined it for the folks that are playing by the rules. Then there's, you know, then they stretch out the time period. For the folks that are repeat offenders, they're, you know, obviously it's a different path, and they've increased the fees, and it's actually a revenue, a pretty significant revenue generator for the city. Granted, they have 150, 200,000, you know, units or whatever, mm-hmm. but, you know, we're a fifth or sixth that size, but I think there's enough economy of scale to really look at something, especially considering the very high dense communities, particularly on the east side that we have here. I wanted to get a quick sense from you. What does the backlog look like? So you have this, your whole workload, right? And so at some point, how do you feel about, or tell us a little bit more about that? Like, how many cases annually, how many cases monthly, and, you know, how is it to manage?
As a matter of fact, we were talking about this not too long ago, and what they were mentioning was the backlog, and they told me, well, Sylvia, you left a backlog of over 2,000 cases. So, and that was just me with my two districts that I was overseeing. So there's a backlog, maybe for a couple of years, but what we're doing now is we're responding to the violations within a two-week period, and so whenever we're caught up, we do some of the backlog to catch up.
And then is that backlog, is that separated strategically into different buckets? Like priorities, I would imagine, for health and safety related versus, you know, maybe it's weed abatement or something else. That's
yeah, the health
less.
And safety is what is priority for us.
Is a priority, mm-hmm. right. So it's just...
And health and safety for us is illegal garage conversions, people living in recreational vehicles, sheds, those type of complaints.
Okay. I really appreciate all your feedback and presentation. Thank you.
You're welcome. Anything else?
Any other comments from the commissioners?
No. Well, thank you so much. Have a good day.
Okay. Moving to next item, follow-up reports.
I don't have any from June.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, I could, at this point, given that we have only limited opportunities in the agenda after this, I'll follow up on a few planning-related items that the department is handling right now, and if you want to offer some feedback. But this is something, a few things that I've reported on before, and just that they're progressing along. You may have all been aware of the Downtown Vibrancy Plan. I'm doing my final editing right now. So this has already been presented to the council in a draft form. Council said, yes, we're in support, go back and make your final edits and changes to the report. Those will be happening in the next few weeks or so, and then returning to council for consideration. This is almost a subset of the larger economic development element of the general plan. That also has been presented to the city council and to the community with pretty broad-based support. At this point, we have a consultant looking at that draft and saying, okay, well, this is how you're going to be able to do your environmental review and incorporate it into the general plan, or these are the changes that you need to make to your general plan. So that report will be coming forward in the next few weeks or so, and we'll be going back to council. The three housing initiatives are going on. One is the update of the housing element, and that will be due in 2016. There is also the consolidated plan. That's our plan for over the next 5 years to spend federal dollars, HUD that come from Housing and Urban Development Department. That's basically our home and CDBG programs. And then finally, an update of our inclusionary housing ordinance. So those three are all housing-related, affordable housing-related, and so we're putting together a community outreach plan. It's written into the contracts. We've selected Veronica Tam and Associates, a consultant for the con plan and housing element, and then another consultant for the inclusionary housing ordinance. But the three initiatives, will present those concurrently in community meetings, in stakeholder meetings, and so on. So we're just refining at this point our community outreach plan, and I'll once I have it, I can share that at the next meeting, and certainly we'll notify the Planning Commission as to when the first community meetings will take place. And then finally, we're also moving ahead with the future growth area plans, the West Area Plan and the Central Area Plan. So staff is meeting on a weekly basis with the developers to refine their specific plans, and we'll be starting the EIR process for both of those plans here within the next couple of weeks. Any questions on?
Just a general question. Our new proposed baseball park, will anything about that come before the Planning Commission? Is there anything required there?
I don't have a lot of specifics on it, but I believe it would, because I think it would require some kind of, if not a zoning code amendment. I'm not sure. I haven't analyzed it for that, but certainly there would be some kind of discretionary permit that would be coming to the Planning Commission. But we haven't seen an application at this point.
Play ball.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Of course. Thank you, Alan. Housing, my favorite topic.
Yes.
So lots of stuff going on. I don't know how you keep it all together. I guess you put more plans and more plans and more plans.
I think it's a really good staff that we have.
You need a plan to keep track of the plans. But you were talking about the housing element update. So you mentioned 2016. Isn't that the beginning of 2016? Or what month of 2016 is the housing element?
I think it's at the end of 2016 that it's required to be adopted.
End of? I thought it was 18 months from the time something happened, and I thought that happened like 6 months ago, to where it's the end of 2015.
Yeah, we have about 18 months, and it was 18 months from the adoption of the RENA allocation, which occurred during the summer, so that puts us at the end of, 2015.
Right.
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay, so I'm just...
I was a year off.
Okay, that's a little significant.
Yeah.
Okay, so 2015.
Yes, and then the con plan is actually required, HUD requires us to have that adopted by May of next year.
May of 2015.
Yeah. And then the inclusionary doesn't have a deadline per se, but since the future growth area plans are moving forward, inclusionary housing is certainly a big issue with, those projects are the city's primary opportunity to exercise any inclusionary housing requirements into the foreseeable future. So it's a big issue that needs to be addressed. We took these different initiatives to the Council Housing Subcommittee with a recommendation on the inclusionary housing to have a technical advisory committee. Some folks such as yourself, Matt, but not yourself because you're on the Planning Commission, but others in the community that have that are familiar with the technical details of the inclusionary housing requirement. For example, the Future Growth Area has two representatives on that committee, Brian Finnegan and Hugh Walker, and then also on that committee, the executive director of CCA, Juan Uranga, and I believe Alfred Diaz Infante will be on that committee. And then the committee also recommended a SUBA representative. So we have, I forget the gentleman's name, but it'll be a 7-member committee altogether.
There's a lot of gentlemen on that list.
We have Jeanette Pantoja from BHC.
Now you're talking.
On okay. There also, yes.
We like gender diversity around here. Well, that's cool. So there's a lot going on there. Is this all going to be spelled out in the community outreach plan? Or you're telling the community outreach plan is specific to the inclusion and housing ordinance and the future growth area plans? Or
The community outreach is really a broad-based housing outreach to the community, and it involves really all three issues in all three documents and all three initiatives. So
three being
the inclusionary, the housing element, and the consolidated plan,
but not the future growth area.
No, if there is such a community outreach, that would be a separate. Certainly, it'll be part of the discussion, I'm sure, when we go to the community and the community becomes aware of the future growth area plans. It won't be a specific consultation on the future growth area.
Can you guys make sure to be very explicit about that in that community outreach plan? Just that the community outreach plan covers these three things, just like how you said, right? Because I think everybody mixes everything up.
Yeah, that's the idea, is that I think the community at large isn't going to differentiate
right.
Between the three. Obviously,
I
we have these three initiatives moving forward. A lot of technical details and requirements in each of those documents that are mandated either by HUD or by state law. And so we're not going to go into those technical details, but there is a lot of there is a lot of data gathering that through the census and analysis of the just general housing conditions in the community that the community should be aware of and certainly will affect policies.
Right. I heard you say, can they be explicit about those three things? And then if I understood your report, your response was, well, we know what those three things are and we don't need to be explicit when we're having the community outreach. We'll make sure that we address all of those things appropriately with all the feedback we're getting. Is that what I understood you to say?
Well, we'll explain certainly what these initiatives are.
So the answer can be yes to be explicit about those three things, because there could be people with a sufficient degree of expertise that they do want to make sure that's included, addressed, and it's like, oh yeah, we are talking about this too.
Right, but I think the specifics of some of the requirements will be probably lost on the community at large. I think it will be focusing on gathering information from the community on their housing needs and conditions and what can be done to provide more affordable housing in the community. That's really the bottom line, is how can the city provide more affordable housing?
Another kind of quick area of I'm trying to get a handle on too, is that inclusionary housing ordinance, that subcommittee you're talking about,
yes.
That's got a more technical grasp on all the particulars around that ordinance to try to kind of, it sounds like it's almost a way to kind of hash out some of the big issues, right? Is that how it worked the last time that was crafted? Is that same similar subcommittee with the actual developers who are going to really be coming forward with applications were part of that previous subcommittee as
yes.
well?
Yes, at least two or maybe three of the members of that committee were on the committee the last go, a technical advisory committee the last go around. I believe Hugh Walker and Brian Finnegan and perhaps Juan Uranga were on that committee.
And is that committee, is that something that is going to be, I mean, how much sunshine on that discussion is happening? Is that something where staff is going to be present and conduct that meeting basically and getting feedback and produce minutes? Or at least bullet pointed, here's who said what, here's where their issues are?
Yes.
That's,
yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
So it's a city committee with these folks to basically get their feedback, but they're not driving it.
That's correct.
Okay. The city's driving it.
That's correct.
Okay. Just to make sure. Thank you. And that's a subcommittee of the housing subcommittee.
It is a technical advisory committee that was appointed by the City Council Housing Subcommittee. The
City
Mayor,
Council Housing Subcommittee.
Yeah.
Got it. All right. I really appreciate it. There is a big web of things going on.
Okay, great. Item K, council considerations.
I haven't seen any council items lately. I'm not aware of any up the that have been going through our office. I'm looking at Alan.
Oh, I don't
yeah,
have.
We're pretty slow on the discretionary applications right now, as evidenced by the time frame between the last meeting and this meeting. Our administrative capabilities are tremendous in this city, and we've done a number of applications at the administrative level. That have not involved commission and council over the last 6 months, but that's all I have in that regard.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, and then attendance at next meeting, or when will we have a next meeting?
Well, we do have an item that we're putting the final touches on. It's a zoning code amendment. We've been talking about this for some time. It's a large collection of cleanup items, and we're forecasting that for December. What I would suggest doing is forecasting the next meeting in November, and if anything comes up through our administrative processes that requires a commission hearing, we'll have that available. Hopefully our conditional use permits and other actions do not become appeal items and whatnot that would come and raise themselves to the commission level, but I would just check attendance at the next meeting, and if we need it, we will go forward with it. If not, we'll cancel the meeting.
Okay. Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I wanted to say, I've said this before, and I'd like to utter it again, maybe twice a year I'll say this. All of us stepped up to serve on this planning commission, allowing for two meetings a month, two-hour meetings, getting here, going home, reading the materials. You know, that can be anywhere from, 10, 12 hours. So that's something that we all stepped up to do in service to our community. And I am happy to make use of that time in any way that would be useful. And sometime in the past, we went into further conversations about the alcohol use permits. I heard uttered today that this map with the cell towers would be interesting. Now, certainly we cannot replace our wonderful professional staff, but if there's any research accumulation or making a few phone calls, sending a few emails and routing things to the department's way that I can do, I'm happy to do that because I'm available. I'm available and I have some capabilities and others have other capabilities. So I just want to state that I know we cancel a lot of meetings and that's time that I'm willing to donate to be of use.
Appreciate it.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Since we have a proposed meeting, again, I'll hold off my comment if we enjoyed your serving as a chair.
Thank you. But going back to Commissioner Rojo's comments, I don't know if there's a specific topic. Maybe we want to consider everyone kind of bring to the next meeting just to think about if there's items that you particularly have interest or that we want to maybe look into further. I don't know. I'm open to that.
I know one thing I'd like to see, and it goes back to Matthew's question, is I'd like to see a city overlay, just once, as time permits, with the location of each of these cell towers, like blue for AT&T or whatever, you know? Just so we have an idea. That, to me, that would be sufficient. You know, so we have an idea. Is that a tree or is that a cell tower, you know?
Yeah, we put together a map like that probably two or three times in the last maybe 5 or 10 years. And most of that database is relatively still intact. Some of our applications are administrative and just building permit only. So some of those are a little bit more difficult to find over the years. But we could take another, bless you, we could take another stab at taking a another look at that map and bringing it forward again. It was a an aerial photograph of the city with little black dots representing the various facilities.
And it had Main Street with horses and buggies?
No. Had a data table, though, that went along with it.
Okay. Well, with that, I think we're ready to adjourn today's meeting. Thank you, everyone, for attending.